Just to get started with today's very interesting discussion, and maybe Professor Bello, we can start with you. We've often heard you speak about the need to find alternative modes of growth in the South. We've heard this coming from you, an alternative mode that is not consumption driven as the current model that is today. When we talk about the GCM objective 2, which is addressing drivers of migration, there is a strong emphasis on the SDG agenda as a way to realize this minimizing of drivers themselves. So, I mean, my first question to you, and this is really to kind of frame the discussion, is the implementation of the SDG agenda in itself enough for the Global South, or do we need to think of a much wider framing?
Okay, yes, thank you very much, Ms. Hamati. I had prepared a brief statement addressing the topic of internal drivers. Can I read that statement? I wasn't quite prepared to be asked a question right off.
Yes, we can start with the statement, and if we have time, we can come back.
Yes, okay. In fact, I had sent this. I would just like to illustrate the internal structural drivers of the export of labor. That is the topic today. And I will focus on two countries, the very names of which are associated with labor migration, the Philippines and Mexico. Now, the Philippines and Mexico as labor exporters, their role cannot be divorced from the dynamics of neoliberal capitalism. In the case of the Philippines, the labor export program began in the mid-70s as a temporary program under the Marcos dictatorship with a relatively small number of workers involved, about 50,000. The ballooning of labor migration to encompass over 10 million Filipinos working in almost all countries in the world today, or some 10% of the population, owes much to the devastation of the economy and jobs by the structural adjustment policies imposed by the World Bank and the International Monetary Fund beginning in 1980, trade liberalization under the World Trade Organization, and the prioritization of debt repayment by the post-Marcos governments in national economic policy since 1986. Now, structural adjustment resulted in deindustrialization and the loss of so many manufacturing jobs. Trade liberalization pushed so many peasants out of agriculture, a great number directly to overseas employment, and prioritization of debt repayments robbed the government of resources for capital expenditures that could act as an engine of economic growth, since 20 to 40% of the budget went every year to servicing the debt. Not surprisingly, according to the Human Development Report of the United Nations Development Program, with a growth in GDP per capita averaging 1.6% per annum in the period 1990 to 2005, the Philippines' economic growth record was the worst in Southeast Asia, with even all the so-called lower-tier ASEAN countries significantly outstripping it. I am not saying that only structural adjustment is to blame for driving people to seek work abroad. There was, of course, the already existing wealth and income inequality. There was population pressure. And here one must note that one of the culprits was the Catholic Church hierarchy that strongly opposed women's reproductive rights and family planning, so that the country's population growth rate remained at a high 2.5%, even as the country's neighbors were able to reduce theirs to 1% or below. Perhaps it is more appropriate to say that structural adjustment interacted with these other variables to create a vicious cycle that drove people to seek work elsewhere. In the role that structural adjustment and trade liberalization played in creating pressures for labor migration, the experience of the Philippines parallels that of Mexico. The North American Free Trade Agreement allowed cheap U.S. corn to flood into Mexico after 1994, severely destabilizing the production of corn, Mexico's main crop. At the same time, structural adjustment policies decimated Mexico's manufacturing sector beginning in the 1990s. import tariffs were lowered from 50% to 20%, and import licenses were eliminated, resulting in the closing down of hundreds of factories, with the labor-intensive domestic textile and clothing sector on the brink of extinction. Now, what this meant was that the manufacturing sector was itself expelling workers and certainly could not absorb the millions of farmers being displaced by cheap imported corn. One estimate put the number of these farmers as 15 million. With very little absorptive capacity from industry, the choice of many peasants was enduring poverty in their homes or in the slums of Mexico City or migrating to the United States. Many opted for the latter. As the economic crisis fueled by structural adjustment and the North American Free Trade Act deepened, migration hit unprecedented levels, with net annual migratory flow in the 1990s being 10 times higher than that recorded for the 80s. By 2006, roughly 10% of Mexico's population of 107 million was living in the United States. About 15% of Mexico's labor force was working there, and one out of every seven Mexican workers was working there. There was a strong element of truth in the sardonic comment that finding eating a living from agriculture extremely impossible, Mexico's peasantry simply moved to the United States. In sum, labor export has served as an economic safety valve, absorbing surplus labor created by neoliberal policies in dependent capitalist countries like Mexico and the Philippines. I would just like to conclude by one other observation that is often missed. Labor export unfortunately also acts as a political safety valve that deflects popular energies from accumulating to a critical mass to which the elites cannot but respond with major social and political reforms. I think this is the dirty secret that has made the Mexican elite so tolerant of migration to the United States, and the Philippine elites create a massive labor export administration to manage the process. The Philippines has often been complimented for creating what many have regarded as a relatively efficient system of labor deployment abroad, that is the envy of other governments. I see it differently. This system functions first and foremost as a political safety valve, channeling outward energies that would otherwise have been a source of progressive change. Let me end there, but I would just like to add that I was a member of the parliament in the Philippines, the House of Representatives, where I was chair of the House Committee on Overseas Workers Affairs, an extremely frustrating task because of the major problems that confront migration. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Bello. And I think it's a really good way for us to get started on, you know, discussing drivers of migration and discussing exactly how we cannot dissociate the economic conditions, the global economic conditions from what kind of constitutes as an essential driver to migration. And I think there's a crucial point that maybe we can come back to later during the webinar, which is really how in certain cases, countries of origin have focused overwhelmingly on promoting migration as a way to really not have to deal with issues back at home, with things that need to happen back at home to ensure that people have the livelihoods that they should have as well at home. Thank you very much, Professor Bello. We will certainly return back to you for further discussion.